And we'll start on page 4 of the blue pages. There is a white evaluation page in the handout, and I'd be very grateful if you'd be willing to fill that out before we. Well, I can't find it, so I'm just going to tell you about it. It's, that's the, it's just a little poor, if you can find that. Okay. So, if I may ask, there is a white evaluation page in the folder. If you'd be willing before you leave to fill that out, I'd be very grateful to you. Anything you write, I will carefully read, and I'm very grateful to you. I also have an email list, and if anybody would like to be added to that, there are various promotions and different things, then you can write your email. Please write clearly. If you do that, someone has to read it. Or else you can just go right on the web page. The instructions are there, and you can sign up for that. Let's say Hail Mary, ask for Lady's blessings on our time of gathering this evening. Hail Mary.
Full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Would you take in the blue pages on page 4, as I mentioned? And we'll look at a couple letters here. This is another woman who was the spiritual directee of Venerable Bruno. Now, she was a religious, Sister Leopolda Mortiviengo. Sister Leopolda entered religious life when she was 17, and she entered a monastery in Turin. And she lived her religious life for 39 years in the monastery, until when the French invaded and defeated this little kingdom in the northern part of Italy, they began suppressing all of religious. And so all of the contemplative religious, they were the first ones, eventually this would be all religious, were given less than 2 days. They were simply notified that in 2 days they had to be out of the monastery. And no provision was made for them. They just had to kind of find some place to go as best they could. Did you find it? Oh. So what many of them did, obviously, was they, many of them simply went back to their families. And so you had Sister Leopolda, who after 39 years of monastic life, suddenly finds herself again outside the monastery, and she's living with her family, and it's quite difficult because she's so used to the monastery that she has a hard time fitting into the family life, and the family isn't quite sure exactly how to receive her either because she's been away and religious for so long. So it was a difficult living situation for her, and she stayed in that situation for the 14 remaining years of her life until she died. And the letters that we'll look at are written during that time, when she is living at home out of the monastery, struggling as best she can. Obviously, a lot of room for discouragement, and she experienced a lot of it. Still haven't found that there. And was not alone in this, because Venerable Bruno himself was also, by order of the French, order of Napoleon, forcibly excluded from the practice of his priesthood and confined to a house he had in the country outside of the city of Turin, forbidden to hear confessions, to celebrate Mass publicly, and ordered to remain there and not to travel anywhere else. It was difficult enough for him physically so that he didn't expect to survive it. So both of them are in a very difficult situation as these letters are written. So if you look on page 4, in this case we have one letter of Sister Leopolda to Venerable Bruno. We don't have any letters of Gabriella, but here we do, and if you could close that, that'd be great, yeah, please. Okay. We do have the one letter to her. Oh, okay. So now we got it. Let's just look at these that we've just gone through this. Enters the monastery at 17, 39 years old. That's a lifetime. It's 40 years almost in the monastery. She is forcibly evicted by the French police at 56, along with the other sisters. She lives for 14 years with her family. Okay? So let's take a look now at this letter. Now, she is used to making an annual retreat, and she has just done that. She has no other way of making it than to do it as best she can at home. And she has just finished this 8-day retreat at home, and she's writing to Venerable Bruno to describe what's happened. So we'll read her letter, and then we'll read this response written less than 2 weeks later to her. So she says, Long live Jesus, so December 6, 1813. My Father in Jesus Christ, I finished my retreat Saturday morning. During it, I was not bothered or disturbed by anyone who caused me the least distraction, which made the time in my room, so this is where she's praying, and before the crucifix, very welcome. I never went out except for Mass. So she was obviously very serious about this retreat. She makes it as best she can. She never leaves the house except to go to Mass. She stays in her room and she prays. I wonder what the family thought of this. You know, at home and for 8 days, you're probably not talking to anyone and so forth. They just probably didn't know what to make of it. Now, Venerable Bruno has suggested, since there are no talks and there's no preacher, he suggests a book of meditations for her. This is by a Jesuit, a fine Jesuit. This is one of the books about the spiritual exercises that Venerable Bruno would recommend. So this book gives developed meditations, and she would read through these and pray with these, and that's how she's prayed over the 8 days. I found the rereading, because quite likely Venerable Bruno has asked her to use this book in the past, I found the rereading of the meditations of Father Jude very helpful. Without, however, adding any thoughts of my own, consistently finding myself too dull, how can you already see, as soon as she starts to speak about her own experience, can you see the discouragement there? The book was great, but I wasn't able to add any thoughts of any real value to this. Finding consistently, throughout the retreat, finding myself too dull and unable to generate a good thought. I tried to pray, I read these lovely thoughts by Father Jude, but nothing much seemed to really happen, you know, as I was doing this. I just didn't seem to be able to find any thoughts or applications and so on. I saw that my faults are always the same. So with great reverence, we can be like, you can see, I'm the same old, I just never do this very well. This is the kind of discouragement that Venerable Bruno is always addressing. And what's lovely here is that we see it in this case. We see the person herself express it. If he speaks so much about encouragement, it is because so many of us struggle so often with its opposite, which is discouragement. And a message of encouragement is so important. I saw that my faults are always the same. I regret that until now I have let my prayer go. So she's trying to live a monastic life of prayer as best she can in the busy, different setting of the home. She struggles, she's not able to say all of the divine office and so on. And she's discouraged, she's disheartened by this. Well, of course this poor woman in these circumstances, but she's pretty discouraged by it. I regret that until now I have let my prayer go. And Even as I reproach myself for my infidelity, I am unable to resolve to undertake it. How many of you ever felt that? Look at how poorly I do this, but I can't seem to do any better. I just haven't changed. I'm so discouraged. During all the 8 days of the retreat, it was only by seeking the help of books that I was able to complete the times of prayer. You know that experience when you decide to make a holy hour, for example, or spend, and you really struggle, and the only way you can get yourself to stay there is by picking up the book and reading and so on. And this has happened consistently every time she's trying to pray throughout these 8 days. It's pretty discouraging for her. She's our sister, isn't she? That's all it is. Yet Father Jude, in the book, says that if we abandon prayer, everything will collapse in our spiritual life. And look at how poorly I pray. And this is a woman, she's 67 at this point, which, given the age expectancy of her time, is almost like being in our 80s today, something like that, physically and health-wise and so on. She's remained faithful throughout her religious life. Even at home, she's doing the best she can to continue to be faithful to it. God must love this woman, as he loves every one of us here. But she only sees her limitations and her failings, and they weigh an awful lot upon her. Father Jude says, if we abandon prayer, everything will collapse in our spiritual life. And look at the next thought here from this author. You can see why Venerable Bruno recommends him to her. And that if we make only the proposal to be faithful to prayer every day, that will be enough. If you have the goodwill and you try, you want every day, that'll be enough. You just never give up. The good proposal, if we keep it faithfully, will soon produce others. And that's a lovely thought. I'm going to try to be faithful to my prayer today. It doesn't go well. Tomorrow, next day, I'm going to try. You keep that up, and more good desires are going to be awakened. To move forward. Here's a key thing. This is why I never finish anymore. Here's a key thing that I learned from Saint Teresa, and it's really important in the life of prayer. And that is, Teresa of Avila, probably almost more than anyone else, maybe with the exception of John of the Cross, and maybe not even, gives a wealth of wise counsel about the life of prayer. And also says that having said all of that, in the end, having a growing life of prayer comes down to one thing, and that is fidelity. Just never stop praying. No matter how poor your prayer seems to you, no matter how long you've let it go, just never stop praying, and you will have a growing life of prayer. And that's so true. I've been so grateful to her for that in my own life, and sometimes my prayer seems so poor to me, but you just never stop, and you're going to have a growing life of prayer. And that's basically what she is learning here. I have kept all the duties of my religious life very badly during this past year. She's doing the best she can in outside the monastery. I spent this whole year doing myself continual violence to conquer myself and adapt to the way of living in our household, but without merit, since I only did it because I had no choice. And without purity of intention. So, more faults, more discouragement. Yes, I did the best I could to adapt to the life in the household and the family at home, but even that, there was no merit in that. I only did that because I had no choice and I had to. So it's just kind of spiraling down a bit here into discouragement. She hasn't said a single thing hopeful or uplifting, has she yet, about any of her spiritual experience. How is Venerable Bruno going to answer this? How is he going to answer this? I bet you can already start to see. All right, so she knows that he's going to tell her to begin again, right? It seems to me that I hear you say that we must always and in every moment begin again. So she knows him, and she knows what he's going to say. And this will be my third resolution. But here's the human thing. It is very hard to see myself always beginning without ever finding any improvement. Even though you say that, it's so hard to be hopeful and encouraged because it's just hard to see that I don't ever seem to make any progress. Years go by and nothing seems to change. Paula, who was a disciple of Venerable Bruno and who was in the city and had helped her during the retreat, was good enough to help me as much as the Lord made possible. I told him, now watch this about communion, I told him that I am always troubled by daily communion. So I go to daily communion, but I'm troubled by the fact that I'm doing this. Why? Because I see that I do not profit from it and only go out of habit, that I go almost without preparation. So yes, I go to Holy Communion, but I do it so poorly, like a routine, I'm not really well prepared. So maybe I shouldn't be doing this. Maybe I shouldn't be going to Holy Communion. What's Venerable Bruno going to answer to this one? So here's what she's proposing. I suggested that I should go twice a week. So instead of 7 times a week daily, I should just go twice. Maybe if I go fewer times, I'll be better prepared, I'll give it more importance. Spiritually, it might be better for me. So I should go twice a week and an all feast day as our rule for the Visitation Sisters, it says. But he, Father Gualla, did not wish to consent to this without your approval. So she's asking him for his decision on this. I find that I increasingly like the little book of our Holy Father, St. Francis de Sales, that you gave me. Venerable Bruno was a master in giving the right spiritual book to the right person at the right time. I read a little from it every day. Remember that page a day? Okay, you see it there too. My health would be very good were it not for some problems with my eyes, a present that heaven gave me during my retreat. So it's a little bit of a nice little present from heaven during my retreat. It does not stop me from my daily occupations. I commend myself to your prayers and assure you that you have a frequent place in mind. I ask for your blessing. I am, in the Sacred Heart of Jesus, your daughter in Jesus Christ, the Holy Heart of the Angel, may God be blessed. Okay, so a week later, Venerable Bruno replies to her. My honored sister in Jesus Christ, I rejoice and I thank God from my heart that you were able to make your spiritual retreat without exterior distractions and in peace. And you see, as I say, Venerable Bruno always begins with the heart. He always leads with the heart. And if you get to know him, you'll know that he never uses a superfluous word. He really means everything that he says. And it's thoughtful, and it's coming from the heart. And this is the first thing. I was really happy. Now, can you see how different from the start his vocabulary is to hers? How poorly I do, I never make progress, maybe I shouldn't go to communion, no good thoughts, all the rest of this. And look at the way he's answering. I rejoice. I thank God from my heart that you are able to make your spiritual retreat without exterior distractions and in peace, as this is a great grace from the good God. If you want, sometime, just compare the vocabulary of that first sentence to the letter that she wrote. So you can see already where he's going to go. He knows this woman. She's a good, faithful woman, but she's discouraged and disheartened, and she sees her limitations and failings, as we see ours. And we'll respond now. I approve very strongly your three resolutions. So the first one, purity of intention, that is to do things for God as a yes to God's will. Purity of intention will unite you all the more to God, and will also spare you many sorrows that ordinarily come from seeking oneself and not God. And then, secondly, a holy tenacity. I mentioned, you'll see this throughout his writings, a holy tenacity in what? In never omitting even a little of your daily prayer and your other spiritual practices. So choose solid practices, a doable amount, but then don't give up. There's a speech from Winston Churchill, a powerful speech when England during World War II was seemingly about to be defeated. And he has that line, we will never, 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 and he just keeps repeating this, we will never, 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 never give up. And it's kind of what Venerable Bruno is saying here. Don't put burdens on yourself that exhaust you. God isn't asking of that. But wisely chosen sustainable practices, yes, because you need them, they're key. And then be tenacious with a holy tenacity. Just don't give up on them, be faithful to them. a holy tenacity in the second place in never omitting even a little of your daily prayer, and your other spiritual practices will discourage. Now, this is the right kind of discouragement. Who's being discouraged here? Yeah, will discourage the enemy from increasing the difficulty in doing them with the purpose of leading you to omit some of them. And then thirdly, as you would expect, the decision always to do what?
Begin.
To begin. If you take nothing else from today but that, you'll take more than that, but if you were to take nothing else other than that, I can begin. I can begin. Nothing can ever stop that. You know, the door is always open. That would already be beautiful. The decision always to begin will close the door to discouragement. Beginning again today, this hour, is the opposite of just sinking into discouragement. That's the transition. It's beautiful. And that will, it of itself, free you from timidity and from past faults. Now remember how she's proposing that I just go to communion twice a week because I'm doing it so poorly? Now let's watch his response. As regards Holy Communion, I give you permission. Now, there are three qualifications on this permission. I give you permission on occasion, so not every week, but and not even most weeks, but once in a while. I give you permission on occasion to omit it once a week. In other words, you always go six times a week, and once in a while you can go, you always go seven times a week, and once in a while you can go six times a week. But even that, if Father Wallen gives you permission. In other words, just keep going to communion. Because he knows well that communion is not a reward, it's a medicine, as Pius X said when he encouraged young and frequent reception of communion. It's a medicine, it's not a reward. Because we've done so well, now we can go to communion. That's the way she's thinking, it was the thinking of the time. But it's a medicine. Remember, Therese said that she always wanted daily communion, which wasn't possible because it just wasn't done during her life. And she said toward the end of her life, this will change very soon, and it did. When you trouble yourself, so the reason why she's hesitating to go to communion, when you trouble yourself about not having good thoughts, when you receive Holy Communion, and in your other spiritual practices, you run the risk of having the Lord keep you in that condition. Why? Because the Lord wishes that we learn well that of ourselves we cannot have any good thoughts. Everything is grace. That's a line from Therese as well. And this is the teaching of our faith. When therefore you trouble yourself about this, it is a sign that you are not sufficiently convinced of this truth. In other words, you see yourself, you're unable to come up with any good thoughts as you make your Thanksgiving after communion or as you prepare. And so you see yourself at fault, maybe I shouldn't go. Gently, but you know, you're thinking that you're the one who can make these good thoughts and all happen. No, no, it's all God's grace. So that when you trouble yourself that even though you're doing what you can to try to be prepared and make a Thanksgiving, and you don't seem to really be able to pray very well, you're putting a burden on yourself that God doesn't want you to carry. It's all grace. Just be available, do your best. That's all God ever asks. And His grace will always do the rest. Can you see why this always comes to me when I go through these letters? Living our faith is easier. Well, here's the true way to say it. Living our faith is easier than the enemy would want us to believe. You know that sense of a hard, difficult, high mountain that we can barely with exhaustion hope and slipping back? No, none of that. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavily burdened. You'll find rest. I'm gentle, holy of heart. Wouldn't it be nice to have that little Bruno as a spiritual director? And, you know, he was, the historians speak of him as the key source of strength for the Catholics who remained faithful throughout these difficult years of persecution in his region of Italy, that most of them were qualified by being spiritually directed by him. You will say to me that you always fear that you are the cause of this, and I will not reprove you for this, but you might be at fault sometimes. But But even here, he's going to flip this on her. But note that only a voluntarily chosen fault, that is, when I deliberately allow myself to be distracted or choose not to try to pray well and so on, consciously, deliberately, voluntarily choose to do that, which he's not doing, obviously. But note that only a voluntarily chosen cause can harm you. All right? So he says, I'll grant you maybe even you were at fault. You voluntarily were negligent. You just didn't bother to prepare. You didn't try to pray well on your Thanksgiving and so on. Even then, no discouragement. Even a voluntarily chosen cause, once we dismiss it, no longer harms us because that very dismissal is for us a mirror. You let yourself fall voluntarily into negligence and you turn to God to dismiss it, you grow every time you do that. Bottom line is there is never a reason for discouragement in the spiritual life. Never. Bring it to God. He's the loving Father of the Venerable Bruno, St. Therese, and so many others know him to be. He is eager. My spiritual director uses a beautiful word. He is eager to forgive us. Delights in giving forgiving us. We give joy to his heart when we ask forgiveness. Look at Therese. The thrill of love in her heart when this novice turns to her and she says, I'm sorry, I was wrong. Wow, if I could feel that, imagine the infinitely loving God and what he feels when we come to him. Remember the picture of the little girl running to her father with his arms open? That's the spiritual life. That's our God. That's our Father. If you like the little book of St. Francis de Sales, and if it is a help to you, all the better. It is a sure sign that your Holy Father cares for you, and you should thank him for this. All right, your eyes. I am sorry to hear of your problem with your eyes, and hope that they will not last. Take care to avoid the cold, which can harm them. He knows, because he's dealt with struggles with his eyes all his life. I thank you that you always keep me in your prayers before God, and I certainly do not fail to do the same for you. I bless you. May God be with you. Your Father in Christ. Okay, obviously there'd be so much more, but I think you can already get the essential pieces of this message. We have a few minutes for any questions or observations. Would you like to raise them? If you want to come up here, maybe speak in the mic until maybe it gets the other one there.
One of the challenges for the daily holy hour, I find where I've got a designated place and time, and then the whoopsies and the glitches start. So this morning, as an example, going to 9 o'clock Mass, we usually have the adoration before that. We had a funeral Mass, and so then it's like I didn't have time to regroup, because I wasn't going to pass on this event here to regroup and another event came up. So I thought that challenge of in the moment when plan A is just, so this is what I chose, was to go to that place, a quiet place in the chapel, and what I call that separation of giving myself to the world, to the chaos, to fighting it. I sat there in silence and in peace. So it's like, what do you do when you have
hoops and glitches? Hoops and glitches in the spiritual life. It's nice to have there. I think you do exactly what you did. You find the best way to pray in the real circumstances, which is what you did, and I think that's beautiful in God's eyes. So God never asks more than the best we can do. He never asks the impossible. And he doesn't even ask what we can do at the price of utter exhaustion, white knuckling, and stretching that last little bit of energy and so on. Venerable Bruno has a lovely quotation in the letter. We didn't have time to get to it, in which he says to another spiritual devotee, strive to do well all that you do in the spiritual life. So yes, do your best to make the holy hour as well as you can. But then he says, but do it with respect for your humanity. Do it with respect for your humanity. Jesus loves this body and soul amalgam that you and I are. He chose it for himself and he loves it. So there are various limitations in being human. Do the best you can with respect. respect for your humanity in that particular case. I think you made a good choice. Yeah. Anything else? Observations, questions, any comments, anything I'd love to share? Yes.
You talked to us about praying or asking intercession for loved ones that have gone before us. What about, how does purgatory fit in there?
In the letter that we read, you have this young boy, the age at which he has gone to the Lord and given everything about it, there's just really not much question that this little boy is with the Lord. So then over and over can say this. How do you answer that exactly? Yes, certainly purgatory. One time someone said to me, thinking that, I don't remember he or she was saying, was kind of chiding me, you're going to go to purgatory. And I said, thank you, that's the nicest thing anyone's ever said to me. Because ultimately, you're going to be with the Lord. So yes, that is part of things, and we leave this in the loving hands of the Lord as to whether a person is there and by when. That's all in the mystery of God's love. But even so, we still have communion with the souls in purgatory and the communion of saints, and we can certainly love us, not less but more, certainly in the Lord. And so they can be our benefactors and spiritual helpers, and all the more, of course, when they are actually with the Lord. So that would be the theology of it. Beyond that, it's hard for me to try to get more specific. I'll just say, for example, my own parents, are they with the Lord? I don't doubt it. I saw how they lived. Only God knows, but I don't doubt it. I ask their intercession. People who love the Lord like us with their limitations and failings, but sincerely love the Lord and did their best. If we can be good, see the goodness, sometimes I think of that. If I can see the goodness in someone, how much more God? So anyway, the theology is what I've said, but I wouldn't have any hesitation. Whether in purgatory or in paradise, we still have communion with them. We can pray for them, they can pray for us. Anything else? And I say, repeat that comment about the enemy wanting us to believe it's just very difficult to get close to God. If you look at the rules for discernment of spirits, what Ignatius says, this is rule 2, I know many of us here are familiar with this, when a person is striving to grow toward God, loves God, and is striving to grow toward God, you wouldn't be here if this wasn't what you wanted. Then one of the things the enemy will do, Ignatius says, is to place obstacles, make it seem very hard. It's a long, arduous, painful, exhausting, difficult thing to ever hope to get even a little smidgen of holiness, and you're probably going to regress and lose that. And it's just like here's a very high mountain and a long, painful. You know that feeling? Okay, yes, I want to start living this new spiritual life. Okay, start, but it's going to be awfully hard and difficult. So if the enemy can get us to see the spiritual life that way, well, all the obstacles and how hard it is, quite easily we'll get discouraged and just give it up, cease trying to make progress. Ignatius says, the good spirit, on the contrary, this is beautiful language in the spiritual life, eases and takes away how many obstacles, if anybody remembers the language, eases and takes away all obstacles so that the person may go forward in doing good. So this is what you'll hear from the good spirit. Sure, yeah. Look at all the people who do it, the same men and women that I am, same humanity. It's God's grace that matters. It's not my strength, and I know He won't let me down. And I can start this way, that's doable, and the Lord will lead me forward. All of that kind of thing. So the Venerable Bruno here is really echoing the voice of the good spirit in the person who wants to go. So if ever you get that feeling that I do really want to live a good spiritual life, but it's so hard and so difficult. reject that. Ignatius has a beautiful Spanish word for that, lanza. Just throw it away. Just get rid of it. That's not God's place.
If Jesus can freely come to us, then we can freely come to him.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The doors are all open. So nothing that can come between you and the love of God. Now, maybe behind the questions, sometimes there'll be individual things. You know, some things are better addressed in the one-on-one, but in terms of general principles, absolutely. Got a hand over, yes. One, two. So let's go here and then there. Are people going to the 6 o'clock mass?
Yes.
Okay, then maybe we better take just this last question, then you can go here. I think a very good resource on all of this is Bishop Robert Barron. So I would warmly encourage reading his little book, Letters to a Suffering Church. If you haven't read that, it's a short little book, just take you a few hours at the most. But it's one of the best answers to this question of the abuse crisis and how to understand it that we have. It's biblical, it's very rich. He also has some excellent YouTube videos that you could, Word on Fire, just a lot. I would say anything that Bishop Barron has to say about any of this, he's one of the most, I'd say, balanced and reasonable voices on this that we have. So it's difficult. Part of what's difficult is your reporting services are not always, to my mind at least, well balanced on this. But he is one that I would warmly recommend. I think that the abuse crisis that we're in the midst of now is ultimately, it's very painful as we go through it, and we're not done with it yet. But ultimately, it will lead to a purified church, which is a good thing. It's difficult when we go through it, so I don't want to minimize that. But here's the bottom line, and this is partly why I gave that quote from John Paul II. In whose hands is history, let alone the church? The power of Christ's cross and resurrection is greater than any evil we can or should fear. There are evils. We can fear them. We should fear them. But there's a greater power. And that redemption fills all of human history. The Holy Spirit has not stopped guiding the church. The Holy Spirit has guided the church safely through many ups and downs and struggles, and that didn't stop in 2013. The Holy Spirit is still in charge of the church, and the church will get through these struggles. And it's very important that we know that the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So there'll be sufferings and various confusions which do their harm along the way, but the church will come through it. And very often in the church's history, times of confusion that are painful as we go through them are the prelude to a greater clarity and strength. If you look at the early councils in the history of the church, most of them arose because of sometimes very severe divisions within the church, but out of them came a clarity that still blesses us today. So it's very important, as John Paul II says in that same chapter that we quoted, it is very important to cross the threshold of hope, not to stop before it, but to let oneself be led. We're in good hands. You know that ad with us at Allstate? We're in very good hands. We're in very good hands because we're in the hands of the loving God, whose Spirit will safely see the church through all of this. All right. If I may again, I would be very grateful if you'd be willing to fill out whatever you'd like on the evaluations. And let's just say Hail Mary. God, let's pray the glory be and praise the Trinity. And then we'll head over to Mass. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be. Spirit descend upon you in your name, that you forever.